And I'm delighted to see that everybody has stayed, of course, for the highlight of our event. We have the great pleasure of paying our respects to Mr. John Platzidakis today. You all know him. Mr. Laskaridis is going to introduce him. Every year at this conference, we recognize an industry personality for his or her commitment to best industry practices. And Mr. Platzidakis embodies that both as under his capacity as at the helm of Intercargo, and of course during his very long business career. So without any more delay, I would kindly ask Mr. Laskaridis, who is the president of the European Community Shipowners Association, to come and introduce Mr. Platzidakis and hand him the award.
Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, I would like to thank the organizers for allowing me and bestowing me the honor to speak to you, to such an illustrious congregation, and of course, even more so, the pleasure of introducing Mr. Platzidakis in a minute. But before we get to that, you will not be spared of listening of a few thoughts which I would like to present to you. I'm sure yesterday, the whole day today, everything that could possibly be said about best practices in shipping has been said, perhaps to a great detail. I've only followed the last panel and a bit of the previous one. And I would like to digress a little bit out of what I feel has been the thrust of the main discussions today and just give you a few random thoughts. Now, I feel that the discussion has centered today around our, what we understand as our shipping world, as our shipping universe, which basically is what we Greeks mean when we speak about shipping, which is our ships, our charterers, our cargo, our crews, so the business we're really doing. Having the experience of the last 2 years going to and coming from Brussels and other fora, I can tell you, and this is something that we really need to pay attention to, the shipping we understand is different from what the rest of the world understands under shipping. Now, the stakeholders, the regulators, the government bodies, the NGOs, everybody else apart from us ship owners, understand under shipping what we characterize as the shipping cluster. And you might say, well, there can't be efficient and profitable shipping without a well-functioning cluster. But when these people address the issues that have to do generally with transportation, they address them in the context of the cluster, not of the ship owning alone, as we tend to do. So this is the first important question. Now, best practices, not only in shipping, but everywhere else, are not an exact science. This is my feeling, and I think this has also been addressed today, although there are, over the last years, efforts to kind of systemize and structure and regulate this, what with the KPIs, the key performance indicators, or TMSA, or different other instruments which one can devise and introduce in order to measure one's performance. But it's still not an exact science. It's like when we used to say and feel, well, this is a good guy, without actually specifying precisely what we mean, but deep inside us, we knew what this means, we knew what it implies, and we knew, you know, the allure of this expression. So in shipping, in our type of shipping, in our shipping universe, in our ships, in our companies, we have at length discussed what we can do, what we should be doing, and the benefits that we are drawing from using such best practices in a broader context, of course, we have seen that, and I'm sure we all know and we all remember very well these examples. One of the first times, not the first times perhaps, but when the term was used very much was, I remind you of the issue of the Somali piracy. For a long time nobody was doing anything until the magic words best industry practices was introduced, and of course then we all knew what we have to do, hardening the vessels, citadels, increased watches, and finally also the armed guards, and the problem all but disappeared. Another issue which I'm not sure if everyone is very familiar with is the question of ship recycling, where people speak very much about best industry practices. There is a big debate in Europe which is quite confused and I must say not too concise and not too clear. On the other hand, there is in place today the Hong Kong Convention, which I'm sure many of you have heard of, but this also rotates, it's coming into force, rotates around certain countries, especially the countries which have large ship recycling industries like India, conforming to what the rest of the participants in the convention understand as best practices. And unless and until this happens, clearly the convention will not come into force. Of course, there are also best practices in soft issues, as was discussed during the last panel. I have said that there are efforts going on today to actually organize and structure this in a better way. There are also examples of best practices leading to direct benefits and direct economic and financial benefits for the shipowning community. Take a simple example like the CO2. Now, CO2 and greenhouse gases debate is probably the subject which mostly dominates the discussion in shipping today. But let's remember that using best practices in this area and trying to concretize them in whatever measures we can take to make the ships more efficient and operationally more viable lead to direct benefits to our pockets. But at the same time, they lead to direct concrete benefits for the, to concrete results for the benefit of the entire greenhouse debate in lowering emissions. Finally, I would like to pick up on the last question which was discussed in the previous panel, which slightly touched upon, I meant to expand a little bit on, which is, well, we have discussed what happens in our own companies, in our own relation with the markets and the regulators and everybody else. But I would like very quickly to give you a sort of bird's eye view of some of the issues that were discussed today, putting them into a context of the general world, but I am more familiar with European shipping policy. And if you look at the introductory document of today's conference and the topics which are mentioned there and which have been the subject of the discussion today, you find some out of the 8 or 9, you find 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, which are directly related and in fact are almost synonymous with some of the main points which are discussed in European shipping policy today. The industry challenges and the roadmap ahead, the environmental debate, crew situation, connecting ports, vessels and people, and best industry practices for corporate culture and competitive advantage. Now, in Europe people are using different words, but in essence they are saying the same thing. Industry challenges and the roadmap ahead is one of the topics, the main topics and the main pillars of the European shipping policy as produced and established by the European Commission and the European Commissioner for Transport, and I'm sure you all may have heard Mrs. Bulc speaking about her four-point policy. So the way ahead, the future of the European maritime policy is one thing, environmental regulation and compliance, this normally goes under the debate of greenhouse gas debates and decarbonization of shipping in the future. Crew welfare, we call this the social agenda, which covers almost exactly what is mentioned here. Connecting ports, vessels and people, this is dealt with under a funny, not funny, but a slightly incomprehensible catchword, which we call the European single window, and it covers a lot of things under it, like intelligent European regulation, unification of procedures between different modes of transport, between ports, ships, and everybody else. This is the European single window. And, of course, the best industry practices in relation to competitive advantages is the fourth pillar of the European shipping policy, which is the competitiveness of the fleet and the competitiveness of the European shipping industry compared to other shipping centers outside Europe. And funnily enough, whilst this is the proclaimed policy of the European regulator, our regulator with whom we have to battle every day, is the same set of issues that has arisen out of a recent, a few months ago in April, a quite private and secluded seminar which the Commission has staged and which I had been invited to take part, which again spoke about the challenges for shipping over the next 20 or 30 years. And perhaps unsurprisingly, almost all the issues which I've just mentioned and which are just the issues or many of the issues which have been dealt in your conference today have been the same, but with slight differences. I can perhaps tell you that on the top of the list of the challenges, all the likely developments in the next 20 or 30 years, digitalization of shipping has come out on top. The single European window, the unification and simplification of procedures, has also featured very high in the agenda. Perhaps a little bit surprisingly, because we don't speak too much about this, has been the issue of dealing with the rights of European shipping in foreign countries. And remember, the European shipping, in the sense, as I tried to explain before, being understood in Europe and by the European stakeholders, and they are not only the European Commission, there's a whole array of them, there's the European Council of Ministers, there's the European Parliament, there are the NGOs and environmentalists, and all of them have an extremely important influence and bearing on the way the regulators think and decide. So, the point of trying to achieve for European shipping the same rights as are afforded today to Far Easterners has been very important, and there have been a lot of complaints, why should Chinese or others be able to buy ports and other installations in Europe, and it's near impossible for a European company to go and do the same in China. And just to finish, one observation which I made and came to my mind is we have discussed this issue of best practices in what you could term the, let's say, the established way. We should do things in the proper way, we should do things in the way they develop, we should things in the way we are trying to improve things, to improve the systems with which or under which our companies work. And I would like to simply flag out the issue of something which has become extremely fashionable these days and which we call disruption. Now, what is disruption? I think disruption is and which is in great fashion, I must tell you. And not only shipping, Now, what is this disruption? I think disruption is what we old people used to call thinking out of the box. Except it not only limits itself in thinking, but it actually calls about doing something. And this doing something is turning your company upside down and think everything from the beginning and try to do things in a completely different way to the one you have been doing it today. Now, quite frankly, I thought this was utter garbage, quite frankly, until I've read a big article and a big interview by Tom Enders. Now, I'm sure many of you know that Tom Enders is the chief executive of the entire Airbus group. And this guy has delegated to his chief technical officer, his chief engineer, to look at the entire Airbus group from the point of view of disruption. Forget everything they are doing, forget the way they are doing it, and look at it under a completely different way, which is challenge the existing way of doing things and trying to see whether different revolutionary ideas can bring a better result. Now, we in our shipowning companies are not that far, I'm sure. I think we're doing extremely fine the way we do. We're improving ourselves all the time. Greek and European shipping enjoy a perfect reputation. And once again, I would like to thank the organizers, and I would like to thank you for your patience to listen to me. And Mr. Chairman, this is all I propose to say. And I would take any questions if there are any. Otherwise, I think we should proceed to the most important and pleasant part of the proceedings. And to do that, maybe invite Yanis.
Mr. Laskaris, before you invite him back, if you allow me, I would like to extend a special thanks to you for joining us today. Because besides, of course, knowing Mr. Laskaris for a long time, we were very lucky to have you, given your standing in the industry, but also your institutional role.
Are you sure?
I'm very sure. So I want to say that I'm particularly honored and happy to have you here.
One can say about Yanis is that I've never felt myself in the position to say, what is this guy talking about? I always found his positions and his statements and his explanations, you know, very credible and very meritorious. Particularly in his latest position as president of Intercargo, I think, I don't follow his organization very well, but I think that he has produced an extremely positive work because A, and maybe the audience can verify this, I hear much more about Intertanko and about what they're doing. I feel that they produce much more credible and useful output for us in the shipping companies. And I also understand that the organization has become much more dynamic and grown in size very healthily since Yanis took over. In short, Yanis is an excellent representative of the best that we have in our shipping industry, not only in pure ship management, but in a broader role, which gives credit to us. As I said, he leads one of the most important international shipping associations. We are very lucky that other distinguished colleagues like Nick Tsakos and Tasos Omelianopoulos lead other organizations. And I think this award is extremely well merited. And my congratulations to my friend.
Οι φωτογράφοι.
Dear Mr. Laskaridis, dear Anon, thank you very much for taking the time and thank you very much for your very kind introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. The topic today is operational excellence. But then we should ask ourselves, is there an alternative? Can we do otherwise? Shipping operates in a highly competitive and highly regulated environment. Flag states or state control, classification societies, charters, shippers and receivers, terminals, vetting organizations, etc., want to have, and they do have, a view of the vessels they're engaging with. Therefore, shipping, and by that I mean ship owners and ship managers, have to comply with regulations, local regulations, international regulations, and at the same time face fierce competition in the market. The performance criteria is quality and operational excellence. With the easy flow of information via the internet and the media, any non-compliance is immediately identifiable and attached to the vessel and the operator involved. Quality is expensive, difficult to achieve, and the end result of an ongoing process. The opposite option, though, i.e. non-compliance, poor performance, accidents, can prove to be very detrimental for the company involved to continue as an ongoing company, as an ongoing entity. As said, if you think that that quality is expensive, try an accident. Good reputation takes time to be gained, and the loss of it, unfortunately, can take only 1 minute. Shipping is striving for quality and is looking forward to adopt and comply with all regulations that are practical, transparent, and they pay respect to the shipping industry as it is one of the most valuable contributors to the high living standards which their society is enjoying. Our industry has a relatively low public image, and the only way to address it is by excellent performance, by quality. Transshipping operates at considerable distance from our offices, and that makes ship management a very unique operation. Despite the distance involved, we at the offices are asked to know exactly what is happening on board our ships, although we are far apart. This is the very reason, actually, that I believe that shipping's most valuable asset is the crew, because those are the persons that ensure that the vessels operate up to our expectations. Therefore, I would like to share this award with our seamen, the whole sector of shipping, and all the people that involve your industry. At the same time, I would like to share it with Mr. John Akilikousis, for whom I work since 1989, i.e. for the last 29 years. I would also like to share this award with my family, my wife, my children, my grandchildren, and as I refer to them, the children of my children, because they allocate to me time they deserve to have in order to enable me to continue to be engaged in shipping. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being here this afternoon. It is a great honor for me. Dear Mr. Gorzonis, dear Nicholas, thank you very much for this award, and thank you for the Capital Link events which add value, quality and substance to our sector. Once again, thank you very much for sharing this award with me, and have a nice evening.
Thank you very much. Frankly, we are moved and happy to have you with us and have the opportunity to pay our respects to you. I think Mr. Laskaridis very eloquently described what you have achieved, and clearly you have made a difference, and you continue to make a difference, so we're delighted that you accepted the actually. You know, when I called Yanni with the award, it took him some time to come back and say yes, and it made me quite nervous because I sincerely believe that he was a more than worthy honoree, so thank you very much. I would like to thank you. Okay. I would like to thank you all very much for, first of all, thank you for the great words you said about the Capital Link Forums. These are labor of love to a large extent. And thank you to all of you for exactly giving us the opportunity to continue with this work. Thank you to all the sponsors of the event, of course the participants, the speakers, all of those who travel from abroad to be here. As you know, we host in Greece, our biggest event is every February. And this event we used to do in London, but I think we moved it now to Athens, focus on operations, and I think at the end of the day, as Mr. Laskaridis said, here we have a great cluster. And I think having the event here in Athens is a recognition of the vibrancy of the cluster. And I would like to invite you all to our February event, where we, one of the great panels we will have is February 8 in Athens. And we are going to have a panel, among others, with the four heads of the International Associations of Shipping, Binko, Mr. Bayanopoulos, Mr. Lazidakis, Mr. Cargo, John Tsakos of Intertanko, and of course Mr. Laskaridis for the European Ship Owners. So here we have the global industry, and the four heads of the global organizations are Greek, I think that says something. So I'm not taking the ethnic approach. So please come back, and thank you again very much for a great day and a long, long day, but I think a very productive one. Thank you.
Gracias.